Okay, we have communion today, and we are going to use continuous communion. We had some discussion about what would work out best, and that is what we decided upon. And of course, we do have persons who are viewing from home who will be participating in communion as well. So there will be a point in the communion service in the liturgy for everyone at home to receive their bread and wine or juice or whatever fruit of the vine is available. We are receiving donations today for the Line Mountain Food Bank. Of course, the table is in the back, and your donations are always very much appreciated. Of course, this is a holiday weekend, the 4th of July, and a little different this year, but we still have something to celebrate. It's an important weekend for all of us as patriots. And we're kind of gradually getting back to having a few more activities here at the church. The cemetery meeting is on Tuesday, as you see in your bulletin. Bob Bonowitz's memorial service will be here on Wednesday. The WELCA meeting is next Monday, July the 13th. And just want to correct the date. The service in the Grove with Mend of Heart is going to be on July the 19th. And then since we are having a service in the Grove on that day, we're going to postpone the special offering and the collection for the backpack program to the following Sunday. And on July 19th in the Grove, we will be taking a special offering, a love offering for the group that will be providing really the entire service for us on that day. For our summer special music, sign-up sheets are posted. So if you're talented or if you have a budding talent, you would like to try your hand, you're welcome to sign up. The Shoebox Ministry listings for June and July are in the bulletin, and I know we're always very generous in supporting that program. We have a thank you today from Catherine Lebo for the birthday greeting she received. And having birthdays this month are Betty Michael on Tuesday and Ken Latshaw on July the 28th. Are there any other announcements before we turn to the prayer list? Okay, we're adding for prayers today Gordon Young and Ashley Shoemaker, and also the family of Lloyd King. I'm sure we've all heard about that very tragic situation where the young Amish man was killed in a tragic accident not too far from here. So we will be praying for his family. Anyone else who should be added? Well, then I would invite everyone to continue to prepare for worship by listening to the prelude. Please stand if you are able for our morning confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance, and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray. You are great, O God, and greatly to be praised. You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. Grant that we may believe in you, call upon you, know you, and serve you through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The first lesson is written in Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 12. Rejoice, rejoice, people of Zion. Shout for joy, you people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He comes triumphant and victorious, but humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. The Lord says, I will remove the war chariots from Israel and take the horses from Jerusalem. The bows used in battle will be destroyed. Your king will make peace among the nations. He will rule from sea to sea, from the Euphrates River to the ends of the earth. The Lord says, because of my covenant with you that was sealed by the blood of sacrifices, I will set your people free, free from the waterless pit of exile. Return, you exiles who now have hope, return to your place of safety. Now I tell you that I will repay you twice over with blessing for all you who have suffered. The word of the Lord. Let us read responsibly Psalm 145, verses 8 through 14, as printed in the bulletin and on the screen. The Lord is loving and merciful, slow to become angry, and full of constant love.
He is good to everyone and has compassion on all being.
All your creatures, Lord, will praise you, and all your people will give you thanks.
They will soon speak of the glory of your royal power and tell of your might.
So that everyone will know your mighty deeds and the glorious majesty of your kingdom.
Your rule is eternal, and you are king forever. The Lord is faithful to his promises. He is merciful in all his acts.
He helps those who are in trouble. He lifts those who have fallen.
Under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The second lesson is written in the book of Romans, chapter 7, verses 15 through 25a. I do not understand what I do, for I don't do what I would like to do, but instead I do what I hate. Since what I do is what I don't want to do, this shows that I agree that the law is right. So I'm not really the one who does this thing. Rather, it is the sin that lives in me. I know that good does not live in me, that is, in my human nature. For even though the desire to do good is in me, I am not able to do it. I don't do the good I want to do. Instead, I do the evil that I do not want to do. If I do what I don't want to do, this means that I am no longer the one who does it. Instead, it is the sin that lives in me. So I find that this law is at work. When I want to do what is good, what is evil is the only choice I have. My inner being delights in the law of God, but I see a different law at work in my body. A law that fights against the law which my mind approves of. It makes me a prisoner to the law of sin, which is at work in my body. What an unhappy man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is taking me to death? Thanks be to God, who does this through our Lord Jesus Christ, the word of the Lord.
Please stand at this time, if you are able, for the reading of this morning's gospel from Matthew chapter 11, verses 16 through 19, and then verses 25 to 30. Now, to what can I compare the people of this day? They are like children sitting in the marketplace. One group shouts to the other, "We played wedding music for you, but you would not dance. We sang funeral songs, but you would not cry. John came, and he fasted and drank no wine, and everyone said, 'He is a madman.' The Son of Man came, and he ate and drank, and everyone said, 'Look at this man. He is a glutton and wine drinker, and is a friend of tax collectors and outcasts.' God's wisdom, however, is shown to be true by its results. At that time, Jesus said, 'O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, I thank you because you have shown to the unlearned what you have hidden from the wise and learned. Yes, Father, this was done by your own choice and pleasure. My Father has given me all things. No one knows except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son wants to reveal him. Come to me, all of you who are tired from carrying your heavy loads, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke and put it on you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in spirit, and you will find rest. The yoke I will give you is easy, and the load I will put on you is light.' This is the gospel of our Lord on this day. Please be seated." Okay, our gospel for today is a very familiar passage, and we're especially familiar with verses 28 through 30, which are one of the most popular choices as a gospel reading at a funeral. And as I researched this entire passage in preparation for preaching today, I found a new layer of meaning in those familiar words. As Professor Jennifer Kaland explains, yoke, in the literature of the rabbis, was a reference to the task of obedience to God's law as found in the Torah, the first five books in the Old Testament. And so, Jesus here is inviting us to a deeper understanding that will give us peace. And as we know, Jesus elsewhere summarizes the requirements of the law quite simply as first loving God and then loving our neighbor. And I'm going to focus upon the loving our neighbor in the development of my message. For we are living in a time that calls us to a fuller understanding of our responsibilities as Christians for one another. As Americans and as Christians, we have always valued our freedom, but our Christian freedom brings to us the responsibility for the welfare of others. When we interpret our Christian freedom as license to do whatever we want, we fall into that trap St. Paul places before us in our passage from Romans. It is the sin which dwells within us that takes over and determines our actions. It is only through the work of Jesus that we are rescued from our endless devotion to self-seeking, self-serving, self-promoting behaviors. It is only through the work of Jesus that we are enabled to live on behalf of others. And I would have to say that we Americans at present are misunderstanding our freedom and failing in our responsibility as Christians to be for others. We are turning away from Christ and towards the self-seeking, self-serving, self-promoting behaviors decried by the Apostle Paul. That is why we have 25% of the worldwide coronavirus infections and fatalities, even while we have only 4% of the global population. The disciplined living required to combat the virus is just a little too much for us. It feels like, well, an infringement of our personal freedom, which we prize so very highly. For example, the discipline of wearing a mask. Well, it's something we haven't accepted with too much enthusiasm. You know, actually, it's still a little hard to believe that even with all of the advances in modern medicine, the simple act of wearing a mask is the best we can do to combat the coronavirus. But that's the best medical advice we get as of yet. It's not really comfortable to wear a mask. Now, I am actually fairly okay until I open my mouth and start speaking. And then when I talk very much, it seems like I can't quite get enough breath. So, you know, I'm expecting the vaccine in maybe 4 or 5 months, hoping and praying, and it can't come too soon for me or for any of us. But until then, in wearing a mask, even though it's uncomfortable for us, we are all expressing our care and concern for others, protecting everyone in case we are unknowing carriers of the virus. And again, that responsibility for others goes along with our Christian freedom. Christ has freed us from self-seeking, self-serving ways, so that we may live with love for God and love for others in fulfillment of all of those requirements of the commandments. And I would argue that the freedom we celebrate on this weekend is reflective of our Christian understanding of freedom. As patriots, we pledge our allegiance, and we just did, to liberty and justice for all. Now, our personal liberty, our freedom, is bound thereby to the interests of the larger community of Americans. And so, our liberty is not a license to seek things for ourselves at the expense of the well-being of others. Our freedom as Americans carries with it that weight of responsibility to pursue justice for all. And so, may this be a holiday that is rewarding for each of us, perhaps in a new and different way this year, but also compelling for each of us, inspiring our consideration of how we can be a force for the larger good in our communities and in our country. Please stand if you are able. We share the faith that does enable us to live for others through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now, called into unity with one another and the whole creation, let us pray for our shared world. O God, we pray for your church. Sustain us as we share your word. Embrace us as we struggle to find our common ground with our sisters and brothers in Christ from so many other traditions. Free us from stagnant faith, that all of us as a community of Christians might have a powerful and prophetic voice to share with our world. Hear us, O God. We pray for the well-being of the creation. Protect the air, water, and the land itself from abuse and pollution. Free us from apathy in our care of creation and direct us towards sustainable living. Hear us, O God. We pray for the nations, and especially on this weekend of celebration, we pray for our country. Build us up. Guide our leaders and leaders around the world in developing just policies. May our nation be a force for peace in the world, that your will may be done. Hear us, O God. We pray for all in need, for all who are tired, despairing, sick, or oppressed. Take their yoke upon you and ease their burdens. Give your consolation and free us from all that keeps us bound. And we know that there are particular members who are close to our own hearts in need of your care at this time. We pray that your healing hand might rest upon Gordon and Ashley. And we know that there are families who are freshly grieving and continuing to grieve. We pray that you might be with the family on this day, especially of Lloyd, taken so young and so tragically. And all who continue to grieve, we pray that you might be with the family of Bob. And we pray now for these others whom we know to have special needs and whose names and needs we lift before you on our lips and in our hearts. Receive all of our prayers, O God, those we have spoken and those that are too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so, with your people on earth, and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the eternal mystery of faith. Upon us gathered here, and upon these gifts of bread and wine, make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Confidence of children of God, let us pray the prayer that our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. from whom the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. O God of the welcome table, in this meal we have feasted on your goodness and have been united by your presence among us. Empower us to go forth, sustained by these gifts, so that we may share your neighborly love with all through Jesus Christ, the giver of abundant life.
Amen.
Amen.
Of the glory of the God.
life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ. May God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love.
Amen.